Good evening everyone, this is Manas, your friend and tutor, and I'm back with another video on acceleration analysis of mechanism. It's going to be a wonderful session today. The animations are so beautiful, you will understand this entire concept of velocity and acceleration diagrams in a very simplified and clear manner. Let's begin with the problem. It's based on a four bar mechanism and here it is. Just take a look at this configuration diagram. And for this configuration, we already have made the velocity diagram, right? If you haven't seen my videos on a relative velocity method, you must watch it, right? So the first thing is, hold a piece of paper, pencil or a pen, whatever. Make sure you have a compass, make sure you have a protractor, and yeah, all set. You also need this, a roller scale, or you would be needing a mini drafter, right? There is going to be one hell of a construction and it's going to be very, very delicate. You've got to be very meticulous with your approach. So let's begin. The first thing is, you have to recreate this figure, this configuration diagram, in any A4 sized or A3 sized piece of paper, whatever you have, right? Or on a drawing sheet, let's say. The next thing that you need to do is to make the velocity diagram, and then that way is going to be followed by the acceleration diagram. So if you have completed these three stages, stage one, config diagram, stage two, velocity diagram, stage three, acceleration diagram, man, you're almost through. 95% of the problem is already solved. Then you just need to extract data and plug it in into a formula and get the corresponding values, which apparently have been asked in the question in the form of angular accelerations of some links and linear accelerations of some points in the form of E, F, and G. Don't worry, all of this is going to be made so, so damn easy. Let's begin. All right, so the first thing is, you need to observe where the crank is. So we've got a crank AB, which happens to be 50 millimeters long, BC is 66 and CD is 56. All these data have been shown in the problem itself. If you watch, it is moving in the sort of anti-clockwise sense, but this acceleration is opposite. That means there is a retardation case. If you watch, there is a retardation of 26 radians per second square. That is the value of alpha which has been given to us. So alpha happens to be 26 radians per second square. Angular velocity at this angle, at this instant, is 10.5. Well, obviously, if there is angular acceleration, then at all the points of the angular velocity will keep on changing, will keep on changing. It's not constant, it's changing. Why? Because of retardation. Had there been acceleration, again, there also it would have changed. But in the increasing sense, here it is going to decrease. Anyway, how do you approach? Watch. The first thing, if you watch, this is B with respect to A. Let's say we want to find the velocity of point B with respect to A. V equals omega into R, right? So omega for link B, A, or just let's say this is link A, B to V. Very simplistic, multiplied by R is nothing but the length of the link. What is the length of the link? Length is AB simply. So you just need to plug in the value of omega. We know very well that omega has been given as, where is it? 10.5 radians per second. So this is going to be 10.5 multiplied by the length AB. This length has been given as 50 millimeters. You need to convert it in meters. So when you do that, 0.05, just try to do the math. 10.5 multiplied by 0.05. This is going to be, let me make a quick check. 10.5 multiplied by 0.05, and that's equal to 21 by 40, that is 0.525. Velocity of point B with respect to A, that is fixed point, is 0.525 meter per second. So we've got a good start, right? So we've warmed up. Let's do the main session. Here we go. Now, this velocity of point B, right? Based on this, we'll take our scale. So I've assumed this 0.525 as 50 millimeters. So if that is so, right, then 1 mm will be equal to 0.525 divided by 50. And this is the value which you get. You can also find out the value as 1 meter per second is equal to 50 divided by 0.525. You can do the math and get the corresponding value in millimeters, right? Anyway, just watch A and D. These are the two fixed points. Let's fix them. Here we go. So we've fixed them. Velocity diagram. Velocities are always perpendicular to the links. So if you don't know how to draw perpendicular and parallel lines, you should watch the previous video. There are some animations which can help you. In that session, there are some animations which can help you how to make the parallel lines using the roller scale, how to draw the parallel perpendicular lines using a mini drafter. Do watch it, right? And don't take this topic lightly. This is really complex. And once you've solved at least 3 to 4 questions, once you've made the diagrams by your hand manually, then only you'll be confident, right, that you can tackle any mechanism problem. So watch anti-clockwise. So the direction of the arrow, direction of the velocity is going to be in this direction. Watch the cursor, watch the laser pointer, this direction. So you've got to make a vector over here which is perpendicular to this link AB, and it goes like this. What is the length of this vector? It's equal to 0.525 meter per second, but the length in millimeters has been taken as 50 millimeters, right? So that's your point B. This is point B with respect to A. Let's talk about point C. Okay, this is the link. Perpendicular to that link, we'll have the velocity vector. So perpendicular to this link, we'll have the velocity vector. Let's make it. So somewhere along this line, there is going to be point C. We don't know the exact location yet, but we can work it out. Again, with respect to point D, this is the link CD. C's location with respect to D. Again, this is the velocity diagram, so we're interested in a perpendicular line. Rather, I should say, we are interested in a line or a vector which is perpendicular to this link CD. So make a line perpendicular to this link CD. This intersection is going to give you point C. And these are the vectors, C with respect to B. This is C with respect to D. Done. Velocity diagram is done. So that's velocity diagram for you. Now with this, we can make the acceleration diagram also. And let me show you something. We've got to create a table. Okay, it's going to be something like this. Here we go. Now, this length was known to us, B with respect to A, that is 0.525 meter per second. We took it as 50 millimeters, isn't it? Now, these two lengths, C relative to A, C relative to D, okay, and C relative to B, measure them. Their values are going to be 32.3 and 38.14. Now, these are the values that I have extracted from a machine, AutoCAD, right? I did this initially on AutoCAD. You guys are going to implement this on a drawing sheet, so it's not possible to get this accurate, okay? So don't worry. Even if you get the value as 33 millimeters for this 32, and if you get 39 or 40 millimeters, well, it's possible. We are humans, right? But make sure whenever you are attempting such problems, you've got to be extremely focused, right? Okay. Now, this is in millimeters. What do you need to do to convert it into meter per second? Okay, the answer being very simple. You just need to multiply it. Look here. 50 mm is 0.2525. When you divide this 0.525 by 50, that is over to the LHS, we have got 1 mm is equal to 0.0105. So multiply these two values by 0.0105. This is what you get. Okay, very simple. Now you can make this acceleration table. So basically two things which you need to remember. Centripetal acceleration, that's V square by R. All the velocities can be worked out from this table, right? Tangential acceleration is alpha R. Alpha for link AB has been given, and that is also quite interesting in terms of its nature is retarding. That means the angular velocity will not increase, rather it will decrease. The acceleration is negative, that is a retardation case, decelerating case. Okay, it will always be opposite to the direction of tangential velocity. You'll understand what I'm talking about. Just watch. So V square by R, V square of link BA. How much is velocity? 0.525. 0.525 and it's square divided by R. Length of link is 50. 0.05 meters. Do the math. That's it. Tangential. Okay, for that you need alpha R. Alpha A is 26. It's been given in the question. Multiplied by R is the length of link AB. That is 50 millimeters. That is 0.05. Just do the math. That is 1.3. Right? How are you going to choose the directions? We'll talk about that in the acceleration diagram. Similarly, centripetal acceleration for both BC and CD can be calculated. For BC, here it is. Where is it? 0.34 and its square divided by the length is 40 plus 26, that is 66.066 meters. And for CD, it is going to be 0.4 square divided by CD is 56.056. And yes, that's quite easy, isn't it? Now, looks a crisp table. All the values which we got, centripetal tangential of various links. This is link AB, this is link BC, this is link CD. I've written them down. At least what we know, I've written them down. And there is corresponding length in millimeters have been done. Look, we know these values. What we are going to assume is 5.513. That is the centripetal acceleration for this link AB, B with respect to A. We are assuming it as 100 millimeters. So based on this, if you watch, this is in meters per second square. Guys, just a bit of math will be involved. Let me see. 100 mm is equal to 5.513. 100 mm is equal to 5.513 meter per second square. We need to know. Now, these values we have already got in meter per second square, but now we need to make the acceleration diagram. And acceleration diagram takes values in millimeters and not meter per second square. Okay, so we need to convert them into their corresponding mm values. If you watch, 1 meter per second square will be equal to 100 divided by 5.513. This value precisely, show 100 divided by 5.513, this value will precisely work out as 18.1389. So 18.14, let's say, what, millimeters. So what you need to do is you need to multiply all of these values by 18, this, just like this, 1.3 into 1.3, if I do, the value will be 23.58. okay, 23.58. similarly, 1.750 when multiplied by this 18.14 will give you the value as 31.7. see this, 31.7. okay, so that's how conversions can be done. Now let's jump over to the acceleration diagrams, and we need to fix points. A and D are fixed. Let's have them. Okay, AB, centripetal acceleration component will be parallel to the link. So, and it will be directed towards the center, right? Towards the center. V with respect to A, that means towards A this way. That's centripetal acceleration for you. Then, and this is the most difficult part, and this is the case of deceleration or retardation. If you watch, the tangential component will be perpendicular to AB. So again, whether to move perpendicular to AB. So this is the velocity and the acceleration. Just try to work out whether acceleration will be in this direction or in this direction. In both the cases, it is going to be perpendicular. Tell me whether option 1 is correct or option 2 is correct. Try to think, which is the correct option? Option 1 or option 2? Obviously, you need to draw a line of 23.5. okay, so whether that has to be drawn over here or here, well, that has to be decided. See, this is a case of retardation. The angle, this velocity happens to be acting along this direction. Velocity B with respect to A is acting along this direction. Okay, this direction. But the acceleration is exactly opposite in nature. It is a retarding nature. It is going to decrease the velocity. So you have to take the direction of acceleration opposite to that of velocity. That means option 2 is correct. And that is why we are going to make a vector right here. Okay, let me erase all of this. Yeah, I think I should talk about this once again. This is really complicated stuff. I can understand. My deepest sympathies with all of you. Look, the velocity, the tangential velocity will be in the upper direction, northwest to be very precise. Yeah. If alpha was accelerating, then it would have been in this direction. Here alpha is decelerating. That means opposite to that of tangential velocity. Opposite to that of this velocity is this direction. That's it. If I change the direction of alpha, then FTBA would have been made in this direction. In the next problem, you'll see an accelerating case and you'll understand it automatically. Don't worry. Okay. Join A1 with this point B1. That is the total acceleration. This is the total acceleration, which happens to be the vector sum of this centripetal and tangential, right? To be very mathematical, under root of this square plus this square is equal to this much. Done. Very easy. So we have A, we have D, A1, D1. We now also have B1. Now we wish to find the location of C1. How can we do? Let's approach from B. B with respect to C. B with respect. No. C with respect to B. B has been located. C with respect to B. Again, this is. Let me have the highlighter out. C with respect to B. This is radial. This is C with respect to B. This is tangential. All right. Watch. This value has been calculated. Do the conversion. Multiply this 1.75 by 18.14. Do the conversion. This is what you are going to get. So a line of 31.751 millimeters has to be drawn. Okay. But again, in what direction? This is C with respect to B. So we have to start making the line from B1. Right. So move parallel. Move parallel. But again, towards the right or towards the left? What direction? C with respect to B. C with respect to B. This is in the left hand side. So this is going to be in the left hand side. Again, parallel. Done. So if you ask, so what is the length of this? It's 31.751. Again, you can take it as 35 millimeters. That will do the job, right? If you implement this on AutoCAD, I will take the actual values, right? Does not decimal places can be dealt easily in on a software, but not manually, right? Now we know nothing about this tangential acceleration. We neither know its magnitude nor its sense. So what we can do is simply make a perpendicular line to this blue line that is going to somewhere here. We'll have the tangential component. The exact location, well, it's not known to us yet. And as far as, so that's done now. Let us try to locate C with respect to point D now. So C with respect to D, centripetal, C with respect to D, centripetal. This is going to be parallel, but again, in what direction? Towards D, downwards. That's it. How much is this? 51.95. Now, we know nothing about the tangential component. So the best thing to do is draw a line perpendicular to this green color line. And here we go. And they happen to intersect. These two happen to the tangential of BC, the tangential of CD. They intersect somewhere here. That's C1 for you. And this, by the way, is going to be the tangential component of CD. This is going to be the tangential component of CB. Here we go. That's CB, FTCB. This is FTCD. And this over here, this line will be the total acceleration, right, of the link CB. And this line, this green colored solid line, will represent the total acceleration of link CD. So that's done. So our acceleration diagram is almost done. Okay, so there are some calculations which we need to carry out. Watch. E, F and G. How can you locate E, F and G? Sounds a bit tricky. Not that tricky. E is actually in between points B and C. So in the acceleration diagram, it is going to be between B1 and C1. E happens to be at a distance of 40 millimeters, right, in the configuration diagram. So E will be at a certain distance. Let's say E1 will be at a certain distance from B1. So we can again use the law of proportion. So E1 will be somewhere here. It would be better if I can just write E1 over here and I place a point. So I can write an equation now. Just watch. B1 E1 upon B1 E1 upon BE is equal to B1 C1 upon BC. Law of proportion, plug in the values. BE, that is 40. BC, that is 40 plus 26. It's BC. This should be written as 66. I forgot to write it. Don't worry. Right? And then B1 C1, you just put your scale over here. Right? Extract the length, put it over here. That is 50.55. Right. And once you plug in all the values, by the way, this BC should have been written. I forgot to write it. This is 66 millimeters. So you solve for B1 E1 and this is what you get, 30.63. So basically what you need to do is from B, you need to draw a line over here. And rather, let me erase this. Where is the eraser? Now let me show you. Here we go. So E1 is at a distance of 30.63 from B1. Did you see that? That's E1. Did you see? A red line is going to overlap this blue line. That's E. This is E. Once again, that's E1, right? Done. Now. Let's talk about this. How point F can be located and how exactly point G can be located in the acceleration diagram. This is going to be fun. Well, I'm sure you guys must be shocked to see that F1 and G1 have already been located, but not to worry. There is some logic behind it and I'll let you know what that is, right? So take a look at this sort of angle CBF, this angle CBF. So there are exactly two methods, and this first method is quite simpler, very less time consuming. So watch this angle CBF, right? Measured starting from C, B and then F. That's the angle. Let me show that angle to you. Here we go. That same angle has to be plugged in over here. CBF. C, then B, then F. And it's going to be a beautiful animation. Enjoy the show. Here we go. That's CBF for you. Amazing, isn't it? The angle which was here has been transplanted over here from the configuration diagram and into the acceleration diagram. Beautiful, isn't it? Now, secondly, you can do the same stuff for this angle. That is angle, let's call this as FCB. Let's do it. Here we go. Where is the angle? Yeah, red color, you see? FCB. In the acceleration diagram, FCB. So obviously it is going to be transplanted right here, and let me show you. Here we go. So that's exactly what needs to be done. So in this manner, you can locate F1. In the same fashion, you can locate G1, and I'm sure you can use a lot of common sense also, right? And there is another method, right? And that is the sides ratio of the sides are proportional approach, and let us talk about that now, right? I'll leave it to you which method to use. Okay, use your fine sense of judgment, as I always say. So this diagram, this triangle and this triangle, this one over here and the one over here, all of them are similar, isn't it? This is smaller in size, this one over here is a bit larger, but yes, they are similar. The angles are same, the linear dimensions of the side are different, okay, but they are proportional. So the ratio of the sides are also going to be proportional. So what we can basically do is we can do this C1G1 divided by CG is equal to, for this C1G1 divided by CG is equal to C1D1 divided by CD. So this is known, C1D1 also can be worked out by keeping a scale over here. You can write the corresponding value in millimeters and this automatically can be worked out. Similarly, you can apply the same thing for this portion, everything can be worked out quite easily. But that's approach is quite correct. Yes, I know, but this is time consuming. So again, that is completely dependent on what you want to follow. Okay. Now, our task is over. We just need to go through the calculations and let me show you what all calculations we need to do. Right? Okay, let me show you. FTCB, watch this. Let's go to the previous slide first of all. This FTCB and FTCD, this FTCB, CB and FTCD, initially it was unknown to us, isn't it? But now we know their values. So this FTCB, just put a scale over here, measure the length. FTCD, measure the length and write them over here. Here we go. Isn't it? Okay, so the first thing which has been asked in the question is angular accelerations of link BC and CD. Let me check slide 23. Okay, angular acceleration of link BC and CD, and then linear acceleration of all of these points E, F and G. E, F and G. Here we go. Angular accelerations can be done very easily. You just watch. You have this beautiful formula of tangential acceleration. Let's say link BC we are talking about. B with respect, no. Let me write this as C with respect to B. This happens to be equal to alpha dot R, isn't it? And alpha is for link BC. Let me just write BC. Multiplied by R is the length of the link itself. BC, B multiplied by C. So alpha, obviously alpha BC is going to be equal to F tangential C with respect to V whole divided by BC. And this is exactly how these angular accelerations can be worked out. So damn easy. Let's go back to the slide. Here we go. Simple. Measure this length, FTCB, C with respect to B, FT, this length. How much is this working out? 39.33. This is in millimeters. So you have to convert it into meter per second square. So multiply it by 0.05513. That's why we have done this. Just do the math. This is what you get, 32.85. You should be getting a value closer to this one. Secondly, link CD. Again, frame the formula in the same fashion. It's going to be just CD, C with respect to D. And there you go. Measure this length. This green color dotted arrow that you see is the tangential acceleration of the link, which happens to be 77.96 in millimeters. Just multiply by 0.05513, you'll get the corresponding value in meter per second square. Divide that by the length of the link. How much is the length? CD. CD is 56.056 meters. Do the math. This is what you get. So damn easy, isn't it? Finally, in the second part of the question, we need to work out linear accelerations of all of these points E, F and G. E1, F1 and G1. So for E1, connect E1 with this fixed points. Here we go. Connect E1 with this fixed point, right? Here we go. Measure this length. We want FE. This is working out as 94.14. Just do the math. Place your scale over here and measure it. It should be close to 94, 93, 95, whatever. 1 mm is equal to 0.05513 meter per second square. When you multiply it, this is the value which you are going to get. That's the linear acceleration of point E. Done. Point F. Join F1 with A1. Here we go. Measure this length. Obviously, it is going to be smaller than 94, isn't it? So this is going to be 80.97. When you multiply that by 0.05, you get the corresponding value in meter per second square. That's it. So damn easy. Thirdly, FG. Okay, so G1 with this fixed point, measure this. This is what you get, 74.15. When you multiply it by this conversion, 0.055, this is what you get, 4.08 meter per second square. So everything will become very easy. The calculations are very easy. But before that, there is a lot of crazy stuff. You have to make the config diagram, you have to make the velocity diagram, and then the strenuous task of making the acceleration diagram. And that will only happen if you have a fine sense of judgment, right? So by now, we have finished two lectures on acceleration analysis of mechanisms. Make sure you have seen the first video. That is going to be very conceptual, okay? And it would be more appropriate if you have seen all my videos on the relative velocity approach, right? Then all of this can be understood quite easily. So guys, that was all for today. And a sneak peek into what is going to happen in the next session. Let me just show you lecture 3. We are going to be tackling this problem. What's a toggle mechanism? We'll be making the config diagram. Well, config diagram is already available. You need to recreate this on a piece of paper using any scale of your choice. And then you need to make the velocity diagram and acceleration diagram to find these two unknowns. Okay, so that is going to happen in the next session. And until then, take care, have a nice day, keep learning, keep watching. Thank you.